Hello, Rhonda.
Hi, Lilou. How are you?
Great. I'm so excited to be interviewing you. This is really, really exciting. This is a manifestation by itself for me.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here.
I'm excited to speak of your latest book, about your latest book, The Greatest Secret. Obviously, we know you from this best-selling book and documentary called The Secret. That was sold to 34 million people around the world, translated in 50 languages. Yes. I was actually in the Oprah Winfrey Show when you were there on stage in 2007, I think, in Chicago. And I could feel the goosebumps running through my body of excitement. I'm like, we're making history here.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it's true.
Remember that moment? Was it exciting to be speaking with Oprah?
Yeah, it was. I remember because I didn't sleep at all the night before. Not even one second sleep. And I realized that because I had visualized that I would be super cool and super relaxed. And so I just kept visualizing that because it was not really my thing. Like, I work behind the scenes. So being out on camera wasn't really something that I felt comfortable with. And so I just used the secret and visualized being really not the least bit nervous, but just so chilled and happy. And so the night before, I did not sleep, not one single wink. And so woke up and felt like kind of weird how you do when you don't sleep. But what I realized actually many years later, I was not the least bit nervous. I mean, I was just so relaxed. But what I realized years later is because I didn't sleep, I had zero resistance.
Yeah.
Zero resistance. And so that's why I was so, so relaxed. And one of the other things that I did when I went on that show was I asked to see the love of the universe, that it would manifest in front of me and that I would see it and it would fill my body with love. And so when I sat down, there was a live audience there. And I sat down and I looked down at the people, and they're all people whose lives had changed with the secret. And I just looked down into their eyes. I'm going to get a little emotional now when I talk about this. And I looked at them and just these beaming smiles and just absolutely beautiful, beautiful people. And like saying mouthing thank you to me and putting their hand on their heart. And boy, I was just like, whoa.
Yeah.
So just felt incredible.
Isn't that wild, the electricity that is in the air when there's such an alignment with your vision and universe and you're living it? I mean, how did it felt in your body?
Oh, unbelievable. My body was like, it was like an electricity tower, you know, one of those huge towers. It was just vibrating, like buzzing, buzzing, buzzing all of the time.
Yeah.
And the joy that ran through my body, like these trills of joy all through my heart. And it was an amazing time. And I look back now too on that time and I really do see that I had no resistance. I was not in the mind at all. I was completely coming from the heart. And it was just the most extraordinary time, you know, except I knew what was going to happen. I mean, people would say to me, wow, you know, can you believe what happened? And I'm like, yes, because I visualized this. I visualized it every day for, couple of years.
Let's go back to that moment, because in 2004, you were going to get, I mean, be broke, basically. You had this producing company and you had only 30 days or so to survive. You were gifted, or somebody gave you this book, The Science of Getting Rich or something at that time.
My daughter did, yes. My daughter did, yeah.
And then epiphany.
Yes, it was the night that my accountant called me and said, you're going to be broke in a month. You've run $2 million over budget with the six movies that I was making, television movies. And he said, there's nothing you can do. You're going to lose everything. And so that was that, and hung up the phone. And then immediately the phone rang again. It was my mother. And my father had died suddenly on the 1st of March that year, really suddenly. And my mother and father had just had the love affair of from the time they saw each other. So my mother suffered terrible, terrible grief. And of course, I was in grief. So my life just spiraled downward. You know, one thing goes wrong after another, after another. Yeah. It's just law of attraction, you know. And everything that could go wrong went wrong that year. Everything with the productions and everything. So I hung up the phone, picked up, and it was my mother, and she said she can't go on. And she was living quite a distance from me. So I talked to her for quite a while until I knew she was fine. I said to her, I'll be down to see you in the morning. And so hung up from her, and I just collapsed in despair because these were two things that I had no way of solving. I always thought I'd great at solving problems, but these two things were beyond what I could solve. And I just absolutely collapsed into despair and tears. And my daughter, who's it was in her 20s, walked out and said, what's wrong? And I sort of played, you know, didn't want to. I just said, oh, just something, it'll be all right. And she disappeared and then came back with this crumpled up paper with a bulldog clip and said, here you are, read this, it will help. And, you know, I've asked her, why did you give me that book? Because that book changed my life, yeah. You see, on the spot. And she said she had no idea. She didn't even really remember giving it to me. So I opened the book and I can't believe I started to read it. I had the whole, you know, it's like the whole sky's falling in on me, but I'm reading this. And my tears were hitting the paper and the ink was running. And 90 minutes later, I finished reading it and nothing was ever the same again. And in that book, which we have for free on our website, you can download it for free, The Science of Getting Rich by Wallace Wattles, written in 1910, I knew more than what was in that book when I read that book. I knew so many things.
But you were not practicing it before. You said you completely switched your mind, or you changed the way you were living life from that moment.
Totally, totally. I realized the power of our thoughts. I realized the power of us. I knew we never died. Like, I absolutely knew that without a doubt. I knew it. And I knew that we created our life with our mind. And so that began massive research for me, because I was really like a researcher and didn't talk to anybody about it at all, and just traced it back through history, actually all the way back to the Emerald Tablet. And it was so amazing because they're everywhere. It's in every religion. It's there. But you have to know what you're looking for to see it. And so otherwise you miss it. And so here was this wisdom that our mind is incredibly powerful. We create our life with our thoughts. It's as simple as that. It's never going to change. It's 1,000 years from now. It will never be any different.
So would you say, because from my understanding in The Greatest Secret, the mind is not so much relevant to knowing who we are and how we can truly manifest our being. So how would you say, how did this evolve from where you were at with The Secret to where you're at with The Greatest Secret? Because we can feel it's deeper, more spiritual, less material. What we felt was missing in The Secret, you digged it for, I mean, you went for it during the last 14 years. You studied with the best, most enlightened people. So what is this related to the mind aspect? How have you shifted?
Yes. Well, I think with the secret is just, I will maintain this. It's just the greatest. It was a gift given to me and that was shared with the world. And it is the greatest book for life on planet Earth. I don't think you can beat it. It is so simple. It's so clear. Everybody can understand it. And it does explain to you the power of the mind to create. And that's actually the only reason we have the mind, is to create what we want. But what happens in The Greatest Secret is you come to understand more about the mind and how we're using the mind in a way that doesn't help us at all. because we're using it as our, we're believing every single thought that's coming into our head. And so we're believing things, we're sabotaging our own life by believing all of these things instead of just looking at life, and we're piling up all of these beliefs in our subconscious. And so you understand a lot more about the mind in The Greatest Secret. But the amazing thing is, here is this mind that is only there to create what we want. That's it.
To support us.
To support us. End of story. But use it for that, and then don't use the mind at all, because when the mind is still, then you will find who you are. And who you are is has always been there, has never left you. And who you are is, it matters a lot to know who you are. You're eternal. You don't have a problem in the world. You were never born. You never die. It really matters a lot to discover who you are and to understand that this is just a body you're using to have a lot of fun in an objective world, right? And so The Greatest Secret puts the mind more into perspective. It's an incredible tool, but it's also will act as a blanket or a curtain covering up who we are. So the journey from The Secret to The Greatest Secret, and I wrote several books in between, but The Greatest Secret is my entire journey, and it features in it all of the teachers who played an enormous part in my journey. I followed them, some of them for years, some of them for 6 months, some of them for a month, but all of those teachers changed my life in one way or another.
You didn't met them the same way than the first one, because the first teachers or the secret, the teachers in The Secret, from my understanding, a lot of them were coming from this group of leaders, transformational leaders in the US.
Yes.
That I had also the opportunity to interview, so I really get how rich it is, how much knowledge. But what would you say the difference is between this group of people and this one that you have decided to feature in The Secret? From my understanding, all of them have represented transformation in your life, but is there something else that they have understood that was really at the core, you know, that makes this greatest secret amazing?
Yes. Every single one of them self-realized.
Yeah.
You know, every single one of them, you know, or another word for people would be enlightened if they wanted to use that word. But they are all living as their true nature, every single one of them. Mm. And whereas the teachers in The Secret, they were completely focused on law of attraction and actually what The Secret is focused on and how to have an incredible life. And you can just think your way to whatever life that you want. But one of the difficulties we have is if we're allowing the mind to run us, then there's going to be a whole lot of thoughts that we don't want, and we'll create those and we'll manifest those. So the quieter our mind is, the more powerful we become.
Mm. You featured Muji. I love Muji. I think he's so cute.
I love Muji.
Oh my God. How did you meet him?
He's so beautiful. He's just gorgeous. Oh my gosh. I was just so overwhelmed when he said yes. Actually overwhelmed when they all said yes. They all said yes without any hesitation. It was just beautiful. Muji, I actually went to a retreat of his in Lisbon, and I went with my daughter, and I had already well and truly woken up, and so it was amazing to be there. But for my daughter, he walked into the room, and my daughter was just, that was it. She just had this big smile on her face, and she was in heaven, you know, she was home. And so it was the trip of a lifetime for her. And he is just so beautiful, you know. And I looked around at all of these people, and there's just people everywhere just waking up just in his presence, you know, just such an incredible presence. So
how would you describe that, a person that awakens in the presence of another? How would you rationalize that, or how would you put it in words?
It's interesting, isn't it? Because I've had some letters from people who've read The Greatest Secret and just woke up just like that, and on the spot. And so I just kind of think of people in that way. And when I saw those people with Muji, that it's just like really low-hanging fruit, right? That's just as ripe and ready to drop. Because for me, I guess for me it was quite fast too, but I've been living since 2016, living as my true nature and really consciously living as that. So it's been getting deeper and deeper, the mind quieter and quieter, and just like the flimsiest thought would just create, just like that, because there's nothing to contradict that thought.
Wow. So you just said 2016. So what happened that in those 10 years?
In those 10 years, I searched 24/7.
Wow.
Thousands of books, went through every tradition that I could, studied every tradition, every person, like 7 days a week, truly.
On their larger scope, on their larger scope than for The Secret, because you had digged already.
Yes. And I thought, well, I have discovered the truth. There must be more. You know, I knew without a doubt with The Secret, this is the truth. This is what works. This is the way it works. It's the way it will always work. The mind is creating everything. And so I knew there must be more. Like, for example, I knew we never died. And so I just set off on a path to discover more and more and more. And I discovered so many incredible things on the way. You know, things that people, the general public aren't aware of. And it was an incredible spiritual journey and very, very intense. And I had a lot of amazing experiences.
Crazy experiences, I guess, too.
Which kind?
Some crazy experiences that were unrational, probably, at times.
That's right. I knew things, you know, I knew things. Like I remember there was a family friend of ours and she was having a baby and she was rushed into hospital. I think it was like 6 weeks before the baby was due. And my daughter said to me, can you please give us some light and some magic dust and help her? And I said, she doesn't need any help. She's going to be fine. And the baby girl's going to be fine. And I said, you said she's having a baby girl, right? And my daughter said, no, they don't know what she's having. I said, it's a girl and she's going to be fine. And she was. And I knew it, you know. And so everybody's had that experience for sure in their lives where they just knew something, you know. I absolutely knew that was going to happen. I knew it. I knew it. And so, so I had
Would you believe we're all healers and mediums? And
yes. Yes. Yes.
Some people are more gifted than others.
We're unlimited. I mean, and so what it involves is opening your mind. And when I say opening your mind, you know, really just allowing your mind to go into the background. And most people like to think of themselves as, what are your qualities? Well, I have an open mind, I have a great sense of humor. But a lot of us have a very closed mind. We are closed to new ideas. Like The Greatest Secret presents a lot of things to people. All of it is the truth, but it presents a lot of things to people that may challenge their current beliefs, you know. And so often if we have a belief that is challenged, we're like, oh, no, I don't believe that. And so therefore our mind is closed. And our mind, bless it, it's an amazing tool, but it will do everything to stop us from discovering who we are, because it really likes running the show, you know, it likes it. So it also likes it when we discover who we are and it can go on a long vacation as well. So,
how about the heart in all this? Because you're speaking about the mind, an open mind, but is the heart playing a role to actually perceive and being aware of who we really are?
Yeah, I think when the mind goes to the background and who we are, the infinite being that we are, awareness, consciousness is in the foreground, then you just become just this total joy, total love. Everything's perfect just as it is. Nothing needs to change. You absolutely know that we are all one. While we're appearing as individuals, that we are all one. And no matter what happens, no matter what, even like an intense year, like the last year that we have all been through, everything is absolutely fine. And there's no end to anybody.
Mm.
You know, so you just have this peace that's beyond, you know, this beautiful peace and just joy and happiness. And so all of those things are love, and this great sense of freedom and no fear whatsoever. So even if people just imagine, what would it be like to live my life without any fear at all? Oh, amazing, right? Amazing.
So this is how we feel in the presence of somebody that is enlightened, or reading your book that is filled with enlightened people. Like, there's something to do with the energy, or like we're in contact with that, and immediately we have a glimpse of the experience of the source.
Perfect. Perfectly said. Yes, because I think in the presence, and it would vary, I'm sure, for some people. Like, I'm sure some people went to Muji and that didn't happen to them, whereas it happened to many, many people. But what my perspective is that when you're in the presence of an enlightened teacher, their energy of love and joy is so strong that your mind just stills. And when your mind stills, there is the joy and love that you are. There is who you are. So the moment the mind is quiet, there you are. And so that's really what happens. Their love is so strong that it just, that energy makes your mind just be still. And so all these tears come, because all these tears or laughter of just the joy and the recognition and the beauty of who we really are. Because the mind, you know, it like when we allow it to be our psychiatrist and our psychotherapist and everything, it's really going to say a whole lot of stuff about us that's not very nice, right? You shouldn't have done that. Why did you do that? That was really stupid, you know, all those kinds of things. And when in fact we are absolutely perfect, just, you know, really, really perfection itself. And if we're trying to perfect the person, and no hope. No hope to perfect the person, because it's the mind and the ego is running the person. And so, and they're imperfect. This is the nature. This is why we're here, is to experience imperfection, to experience sadness when we are joy itself. And so we get to experience sadness, and we get to experience the duality.
Yeah.
And
how do they maintain that? Or what did you found out in order to maintain that state? Because enlightened beings seems to have this pivotal moment, and all of a sudden, you know, they're like this. I'm remembering my conversation with Byron Katie. I mean, that's like,
yeah.
It's just pure joy and enlightenment, and she dissolved all limited beliefs. And how do you, is that only for some beings, or do you believe it's for everyone that can stay in that state?
I think, look, I somebody like Byron Katie, it happens very suddenly, and she never the ego and the mind never come back in the way that they were, but that's rare. That's really rare. And it's pretty intense for it to happen that way. Like, I think Katie sat for 2 years in the desert, you know, barely talking to anybody. And I think Eckhart Tolle was similar, you know, it was very sudden. For me, it's been gradual. And for most people, it's gradual. So I had an awakening and I totally knew who I was. But then all through the day, I would say to myself, am I aware? Am I aware? Which is one of the processes in the book, to bring you back to being consciously aware. And I just put in the book what absolutely worked. That worked. There's no, it will not fail. And so the more that I did that, and the more that I noticed awareness, the weaker the mind got, and the more who I am was in the foreground.
Yeah. How would you say we should choose our enlightened being? Or, you know, some people say you should go towards a master and only study with that person, and totally devote even yourself to that master so that you can really be enlightened. Or do you believe it's a matter of, as you did in the book, sprinkling? Because we're also learning in the book how you're completely in love with your own master, I should say, or somebody this anonymous that we don't know, but that you've...
My teacher,
your
yeah.
Your teacher, yeah.
That I love so much, yeah.
So is there one way or many?
I think the best thing is to trust. I remember a mentor of mine saying, when the student is ready, the master will appear. And I for years and years, I wanted that master to appear. And I was like open to, could be in a supermarket, you know, I just wanted that teacher to come. And the teacher didn't come. And so I was like, well, I can't be ready. And so I would just kept following all of the teachers. And sometimes I would think, oh, this is the teacher. But then I would find that I moved on to another teacher. And so if you just trust, if you really, really want this and you want to be free, and you want to be free of fear and enjoy and just have a life that's probably inconceivable to most people right now, then trust, like certainly read The Greatest Secret, or you could choose another book. It doesn't matter. But if there is a teacher that resonates with you in that book, then follow that teacher and follow that teacher until you know, until you feel like you've done enough with that teacher, and then go to the next one. I mean, the next one will appear for you. It did for me. I would finish with one teacher and then I would be like, gosh, I don't have a teacher. Like within hours, another one would appear. And with my teacher that's anonymous in the book, I've had no other teacher than her since 2016.
Yeah.
And she is just, and there will be no other teacher. But I just think to trust that you may go through many teachers. I don't, you know, for some people, there may be just one teacher. You know, you just know. You can get to a point where, I don't know, you feel like you're not moving anymore. And you hear something from another teacher and, oh, it sets you alight. And so I think just trust. Like Lester Levinson says in The Greatest Secret, oh, my gosh, he was the most amazing teacher. But he says in The Greatest Secret, you take one step toward your infinite self and it will take 10 steps toward you. And so just keep doing the practices, you know, checking in and am I aware? Not saying I am aware, because saying I am aware is the mind. It is very specific. Am I aware? And the moment you say that, the mind is still and awareness consciousness comes into the foreground, and because the mind can't answer that question. So it's very specific.
Yeah. So question. I guess this is the best place to, in order to know if it's our teacher in front of us or if we want to, but how do you deal with when there's the crisis, the craziness, the mind that is there and actually you so much want change in your life, but you're not in a place where you're there to be that awareness. So how do you choose and have discernment or choose from the right place? How do you know? What is actually the process to...
You're going to feel it. Like, you're going to feel a teacher. You will feel it. You know, if you were in the presence of a teacher and you were just feeling absolute joy and love, oh, my gosh, you aren't going to want to go anywhere. You're just going to want to hang on to that teacher's arm. Never let them go and follow them everywhere. And so when you will really feel it. For somebody who's not even at that place, I just feel like The Secret gave me the perfect stepping stone to this, because I worked really hard on watching thoughts and not paying attention to negative thoughts and only enhancing positive thoughts of what I wanted. And so for those people who followed The Secret and have really worked at being positive, it will be much easier for them than somebody that is just beginning, you know. So I remember Lester said, first step is to get your mind positive and to think of all the positive things and to watch your mind. To watch it. And when there are negative thoughts, don't believe them. Take no notice of them. So if there's a negative thought that says, you shouldn't have done that, you upset her when you did that, you shouldn't have done that, you know, then just say, there you are again. You know, go away. You don't know anything. And so don't listen to those thoughts and only concentrate on positive thoughts. Then you are really becoming aware of your thoughts. That's a big deal, to become aware of your thoughts and to be able to discern. And so that's, I just think that's the greatest step then to the next step of the greater secret, and then be, you know, becoming aware, because you've weakened the mind, you know. So
How is it for you to come out with this book, The Greatest Secret, after The Secret? Meaning, weren't you afraid? I know this is not in your paradigm, but weren't you afraid that it was not up to how the people that read The Secret evolved? Meaning, because we all had a spiritual past since The Secret. We all tried so many things, experienced life and evolved and got connected. Were you a bit afraid that this would not fit to where most of your public was from those 14 years and how they have evolved?
Yes, and no, I wasn't afraid, because I knew that this was something that I had to do, and it didn't matter if people understood it or got it now, or in 10 years, or in 20 years, or in 50 years. All that mattered was that it was there. So it will always be there for when somebody is ready. But do you know, when we did The Secret, that was way ahead of its time. Like, that was considered so controversial and really ahead of its time. And here I was telling everybody, you create your life with your thoughts. And there, it was just like, whoa. And so that's now been absorbed into our civilization and accepted. And so with The Greatest Secret, it's a little bit the same. You know, I was on the edge back then in 2006, and so I'm on the edge again, you know.
Yeah.
But for freedom and for joy and for pardon me, just a life that is really worth living, and a life without fear and with no problems. Like, just that alone, like, no problems, none. Like, you will let go of all problems. There will be none anymore, because they're created by the mind. And so, and this is for everybody, because you're already that. I'm just telling you something that you already are. You know, this is not something you have to go and find somewhere. This is who you are already. And it's just the mind is like keeping you distracted and looking over here when you need to look over here.
Yeah. And create, do you believe we're creating right now, it's a big opportunity to create the new world, or in French, as we say, le nouveau monde, you know, this huge paradigm shift that we all waited for a long time. Is this the bridge to that?
I mean, I would love to think that the world is about to wake up, but I'm not sure it is. Certainly there's a lot of awakening that has come out of the last year. And, you know, truly, like, my feeling is we created that situation to wake up. Everything in our life is to wake up and realize who we are. Every moment, every second, every word, every picture, every image, every experience and event is leading us to who we are, and to complete freedom and immortality. And so I just think that that was a gift, and many people have seized upon that gift. And there will be those who won't, you know, and so something else might come along. Because, Lilou, isn't it crazy that it's only when we're really pushed and in a difficult situation that we kind of wake up? Because the two biggest awakenings in my life were both in really difficult situations. And so if life is going along really swimmingly, we don't tend to wake up. And so this is, you know, this was a gift too. There's no end to anybody, and it's been really challenging. But if people have been very fearful, it's just letting them see how fearful the mind makes them, because who they are has zero fear. Zero.
It seems like there is a lot at stake, but there is also a lot of opportunities that are arising to create something new based on a new consciousness also.
Yes, totally. And, you know, I would like, it would be great if there was if we all kind of woke up, if everybody woke up, that would be wonderful. But do you know what? It's not required either. Everything is so perfect just as it is. It's all unfolding exactly as it is. Every single being is going to realize who they are. There's no other way. There's only one path, and that path is home.
So I'm hearing that you want to enlighten the most people, so that then other people that are meeting those enlightened people can themselves be enlightened.
Exactly. Like, it would be an incredible ripple effect, right? Like, if you got enough, then their presence would uplift all of the others. So if there are any stragglers behind, that'll be really easy for them, because they'll just wake up and be like, oh, wow, I just woke up and this is incredible.
Have you ever felt that you were a mystic, or that you had ideas that were just like coming to you from a different dimension and other beings, or that you were just really receiving and had this great destiny to share, you know, all of this with the large public? I mean,
I've had all kinds of spiritual experiences, but the books that I've done most definitely were destined. Yeah. I just know that that's what I'm here to do, without a doubt. And so
you feel supported by other dimensions?
I feel supported by who we are. I used to, in my journey, got into all of that, you know, all the dimensions and all the other beings, and I investigated and researched all of that, and it was interesting. But my mentor said something to me that kept me in good stead, because I was having lots of experiences. Like, I could see auras around people, and I could see all this colored light and all these different things. And I thought, wow, this is incredible. You know, it's like superpowers. And so I talked to my mentor about it, and he just told him about my experiences, and he just went, And I said, don't you think that's incredible? And he said, no, it's normal. It's normal. And then he said to me, you must be very careful. You must be very careful that you stay focused on where you're going and not get distracted, because all of those things are just phenomenal as well. They are just phenomenal. They're of the mind as well. So don't get distracted with where you're going. And that was just the best thing he could have said to me, because I could have, you know, I just could have gone around looking at auras all the time. And, but instead, I was just like, oh, that's just normal, and all that light is just normal. And I just kept my eye on going home. And mind you, I didn't even know where I was going, Lilou. I mean, this is the crazy thing. I'm just like, I've got to keep searching. But I didn't even know what I was searching for. And I thought, I'm going to be searching my entire life. Like, this is going to be my life forevermore, searching, searching. And then in 2016, when I realized who we are, all the searching stopped. Just like that. No more books to read, no more. Just stopped. Yeah, just all stopped. And I'm like, once you know who you are, you don't have any more questions.
Yeah. I have one last question, and I'm sure I'll have hundreds of other questions later on for other interviews. And I'll still have questions. I can't help it. I love asking questions.
Oh, no, but that's great.
would you say the focus should be very narrow or huge, as we're doing, or very expansed, focus in life when we do things and projects and when we move forward? Because you speak about that aspect in your book.
For what result do you mean?
Want to experience our being, our awareness.
Right. So when we want to experience our being, the more that we become who we are, the more expansive we become. So we begin to experience for ourselves that we are not confined to the body, that we are actually everything out there as well as what is here. And so what happens is a very expansive feeling, and it's a sensation. And the only way anybody can know that is to experience it for themselves. And I would also say that Everything in The Greatest Secret is for each person to experience, not for you to believe anything, but to experience it, because only when you experience it will you categorically know. And when you know there's no fear, you will not be afraid of death anymore. You will see life in a different way completely, and instead see the beauty in everything, even in a difficult time. And that you will live in a foundation of happiness that can never be shaken, ever, no matter what's going on. And also, nobody bothers you or upsets you anymore.
That's handy, especially right now.
It's really handy. Yeah, so you become very expansive, and so a real feeling of spaciousness. Yes, which is what we are. So very spacious and free. Yeah.
Thank you so much for this interview, Rhonda. It was such a delight to be interviewing you on your book, your latest book, and your journey. Is there something else that you would like to add to this interview or say to people around the world?
I guess the one thing that I would say to people is make it this lifetime that you wake up to who you are. Just do it in this lifetime. You can do it. And it's your answer to every question, and it's your pathway to happiness and freedom. And just make it this lifetime. Make it this lifetime. And that would be the best thing that I could say to anybody.
Thank you so much, Rhonda. And thank you for your latest book, The Greatest Secret. And thank you for this delicious interview that I recommend to everyone to share it passionately on the web with all those networks. It's going to sprinkle. Thank you so much.
Thank
you for this book and this interview. Thank you. Much love.
Thank you, Lou. Much love to you too.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.